Well, good morning. We continuing in our journey through Habakkuk chapter 3, and we're being in the first section of that in verse 1 to 3. And this is really the first major section of Habakkuk's prayer in chapter 3. And part of what's been happening is that Habakkuk has had two complaints before, but now he's at a place where he's really starting to praise the Lord. And that's really what we see in our section this morning. Let's read once again Habakkuk 3 from verse 1 onward and just remind ourselves of the context. And this is what it says there in Habakkuk 3 verse 1 to 3. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet according to Shigionoth. O Lord, I have heard the report of you and your work, O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. God came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran, Selah. His splendor covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise. And I want to remind you, just before looking at our section today, which is mainly in verse 3 of chapter 3, so Habakkuk 3 verse 3, I want to remind you of what we see in chapter 2, verse 14. There really are three major promises that come out in chapter 2, but in verse 14, this is what we are told in Habakkuk 2. For the earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. That's Habakkuk 2, verse 14. Part of what Habakkuk's doing in chapter 3 is reflecting on some of that which he had heard from God in chapter 2. And I believe that especially in verse 3, we start seeing some of verse 14 coming out in Habakkuk's own praise of God. And there are three realities in the life of the person who lives by faith found in verse 1 to 3 of Habakkuk chapter 3. And let me remind you, we've already looked at the first two. Firstly, they are moved from perplexity to prayer in verse 1. Then secondly, they are by the promises of God making their petition in verse 2. And thirdly, they progress forward in praise. And this is the reality that we focus on this morning. They progress forward in praise. They are moving forward in their life regarding praising God. What we see with Habakkuk is he moved from this place of, in a sense, perplexity, of complaining, of not sure what God is busy doing, to this place where now, even here in verse 3, he is praising God. And so you as well, if you are somebody who lives by faith, you will be moving forward in your praising of God. And we see that in verse 3. Let me remind you what verse 3 says. God came from Teman and the Holy One from Mount Paran. His splendor covered the heavens and the earth was full of his praise. Especially that last part, his splendor covered the heavens. There's a sense of, have you ever seen some of the great clouds that cover that are in the sky? And there's almost that type of a picture of the splendor of God which covers the heavens. I mean, if you ever looked at night when it's clear and we've had less pollution recently, if you looked at the myriads of stars and the wonder of the galaxies, there's this sense of the splendor of God which covers the heavens, and the earth will or was full of his praise, Selah. Now, just that first part of verse 3, Teman and Mount Paran are both in the land of the Edomites. And we looked briefly at the Edomites before. Remember that the Edomites were descendants of Esau. You remember the story of Jacob having Isaac and Esau. Abraham, Isaac, and then Jacob. Jacob, his brother, was Esau. And Jacob is the father of Israel, whereas Esau is the father of the Edomites. And we have seen this rivalry throughout the Bible and even throughout all of history. It is such a fascinating study to go and look at the descendants of Esau and see the way that they have always, throughout all of history, even as recent as Second World War, have made themselves the enemies of Israel. And it's such a fascinating study to go and read through that and to see that. But you find that both of these places, Teman and Mount Paran, they are both in the land of the Edomites, which is to the east of Israel. And Teman was a city which was named after the one grandson of Esau. Remember that Israel came from Isaac, whose name was changed to Israel, and his brother Esau, who then became the father of the Edomites. And the Edomites oppressed the Israelites when they were going from the land of Israel into the land of Israel. The Edomites did not want to allow Israel to move through their land, and they oppressed Israel. They were set against Israel. Even later on, actually, when it came time for the people to come back into the land. And this is fascinating because Habakkuk is writing this before the Babylonian captivity in 586 BC. And later on, 70 years later, you have the return of the people of Israel to Jerusalem, and you've got somebody named Tobiah. And Tobiah was an Edomite who set himself up against even against Nehemiah. And so you found that the Edomites were even enemies, even into that time, of the return of the people of Israel into the land of Israel. King Herod was an Edomite, or descendant of an Edomite, and he was involved in the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. He was involved in the persecution of the early church. You'll remember that he was the one who beheaded John the Baptist, as well as he's the one who killed the Apostle James and then arrested Peter and John. And he really sought to persecute the early church. That was Herod. It was his father who was also a Herod who wanted to kill Jesus when Jesus was born. You'll remember that the wise men came first to the Herod's temple, and Herod then said to them, well, go and find out where this Jesus is. And he pretended to want to come and worship Jesus, but he actually wanted to kill Jesus. And so you found Joseph and Mary fleeing to Egypt when up until Jesus was around 2 years old, before the death of Herod, the father of the Herod that was involved in Jesus' trial. They were Edomites. And so this is just a fascinating history as you think through the way that the Edomites have always set themselves up against the Israelites. Even the descendants of the Edomites in the Germanic tribes that were part of Holocaust within the Second World War. But God displayed great power in these places when he brought the people of Israel into the Promised Land. God went with his people through these lands, and the fear of Israel fell even upon the Edomites. If we look at Deuteronomy 33, verse 2 to 4, it says this. He said, "The Lord came from Sinai and dawned from Seir upon us. He shone forth from Mount Paran. He came from the 10,000s of holy ones with flaming fire at his right hand. Yes, he loved his people. All his holy ones were in his hand. So they followed in your steps, receiving direction from you when Moses commanded us a law as a possession for the assembly of Jacob." This is the similar type of a concept which we see in Habakkuk. In Judges chapter 5, we also see this. And this is, in a sense, what Habakkuk is doing, is looking back at the history of the way that God had looked after his people. And he builds up in the prophecy of chapter 3 into the way that God would look after his people in the future. God has been faithful in the past. He is faithful in the present, and he will be faithful in the future. And that's part of the praise that flows from Habakkuk, even in chapter 3, verse 3. Judges chapter 5, we find one of the other songs, and we've got the song of Deborah and Barak. Deborah was one of the judges of Israel, the only woman judge of Israel, and she operated under the authority of Barak. And if you look at Judges 5, and in particular verse 1 to 5, this is one of the 10 songs in the Old Testament, and it follows a similar theme to what we find written by Habakkuk. "Then sang Deborah and Barak, the son of Abinoam, on that day, that the leaders took the lead in Israel, that the people offered themselves willingly. Bless the Lord. Hear, O kings, give ear, O princes, to the Lord I will sing. I will make melody to the Lord, the God of Israel. Lord, when you went out from Seir, when you marched from the region of Edom." You see how the same concept is there. God was marching from the region of Edom, which is these two places we've been reading about in Habakkuk 3 verse 3. "The earth trembled and the heavens dropped. Yes, the clouds dropped water. The mountains quaked before the Lord, even Sinai before the Lord, the God of Israel." And there's emphasis there on the God of Israel. This one who is Israel's God. His splendor covered the heavens and the earth was full of his praise. And this is referring to the glory of God with which he led his people and protected his people through the wilderness wanderings and the way in which the nations of the world were led to fear the people of Israel because of their God, greater than all of the idols of the world. And as Habakkuk praises the Lord, he remembers the past and in the way in which the Lord has protected his people and how he has remained faithful to them, even in this present situation, even in the way in which the Lord has said that this is the punishment that will come upon Israel. Habakkuk is remembering the fact that this is the promise-keeping God who keeps his promises, and he will keep his promise to Israel even in the future. And there's even a greater glory which he looks forward to that would come as the Lord would keep his promises. A greater glory than the cloud during the day leading his people and the pillar of fire at night leading his people. Than walking through the Red Sea on dry ground and drinking water from the rock from Moses and having manna from the heavens and quail given to the people. Even something greater than that was something which Habakkuk still looked forward to, and we'll get more into this in the rest of chapter 3, and that is the coming of the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, who would be given to men through the people of Israel. God would keep his promises. The mercy of heaven would be poured out by the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And this is part of the praise with which we should be praising the Lord. As we learn about him in his word, we should be moved in a wonderful praise of his glorious name. All that God did for Israel was a picture of what he would do in a greater sense through our Lord Jesus Christ, who would be the picture that would cause us to look forward even to the coming, the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, as he would fulfill the word that was given even here in Habakkuk. The earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord the earth, and this is chapter 2, verse 14, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. There's a sense where we still look forward to that even in the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. There's a sense where that was partially fulfilled in his first coming, but we still look like John the Baptist did. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And we look to him. John the Baptist sends his disciples to Jesus saying, are you the one we're looking for? Remember, he was preaching and saying, the axe is laid at the root, and you know, repent, you brood of vipers, who warned you of the wrath to come? And he was looking in a sense to Jesus in the fulfillment of what the prophets were saying in regard to his second coming. The Psalm chapter 2 kind of a fulfillment, where he would rule with an iron scepter. And there is a sense where this prophecy speaks even of that. I want to end this morning with a brief look at Psalm 72. And you can turn there in your Bibles as we think through this concept of growing in our adoration of God, in really growing in our progressing in praise of who God is. Even in times of perplexity, as we look at God's faithfulness, this causes praise to flow from our hearts because we know whom we have believed in. It is our Lord Jesus Christ. It is through him that all of the issues of this life actually pale in comparison to the fact that we have a mediator between us and God. The greatest problem for us has been sorted out. And whether we live or die, brothers and sisters, whether we live or die, we live for his glory. And may this become something of may it cause your heart to truly flow forth with praise to the great God who has saved us, the way that he has looked after Israel in the past, the way that he looks after them in the present, and the future plan that he even has for them. Listen to the last psalm of David, because this is a wonderful psalm. It also ends off with the same verses the same concept as what we're even looking at in today's section. And this is what David wrote about Solomon. But we know that the great fulfillment of what David writes here of Solomon is in our Lord Jesus Christ, the descendant of David, the descendant of Solomon. Listen to what he says in Psalm 72 of Solomon. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to the royal son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. Let the mountains bear prosperity for the people and the hills in righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the children of the needy, and crush the oppressor. May they fear you while the sun endures, and as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on the mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may the righteous flourish and peace abound till the moon be no more. May he have dominion from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. May desert tribes bow down before him and his enemies lick the dust. May the kings of Tarshish and of the coastlines remember him, render him tribute. May the kings of Sheba and Seba bring gifts. May all kings fall down before him, all nations serve him. For he delivers the needy when he calls, and the poor and him who has no helper. He has pity on the weak and the needy, and saves the lives of the needy. From oppression and violence he redeems their life, and precious is their blood in his sight. Long may he live. May gold of Sheba be given to him. May prayer be made for him continually, and blessings invoked for him all the day. May there be abundance of grain in the land. On the tops of the mountains may it wave. May its fruit be like Lebanon. And may people blossom in the cities like the grass of the field. May his name endure forever. His fame continue as long as the sun. May people be blessed in him. All nations call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous deeds, wondrous things. Blessed be his glorious name forever. May the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. The prayers of David, the son of Jesse, are ended. Blessed be his glorious name forever. May the earth be filled with his glory. Amen. And amen. Dear one, may your heart bound forth with glorious praise for the one who has saved your soul and the one through whom the God of heaven is pleased to be glorified. He has revealed to us our Lord Jesus Christ through his word. His praise goes forth throughout all the earth. Praise God that we here in the southern tip of South Africa, in the southern tip of Africa, are able to praise his name, while we have people from all tribes and tongues and nations around the world that are praising his name. We are not those that fear Corona. We are those that fear the great God of heaven. And we praise him for giving us a savior from our sin, the Lord Jesus Christ. May he bless his word to your heart this morning. Amen.